Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Simrace TV's coverage of the GPVWC Super League Championship. We're here at Zandvoort, Old Dutchies. I'm sure everyone's drunk in the hills, and we're just coming to the very end of qualification as the clock strikes zero, and everyone that's out on their hot lap with me, I've got Lee Morris and Philip Cullen with us, but we're just watching OJ Clark popping round in what looks like a good stab for pole, although it's not quite gone well in the middle sector there, Lee.
Yeah, it's very close. This could be the first pole position that's not held by Lucas Euler this season. Obviously, coming around the final corner now, we've just been watching this lap. Can you do it? OJ Clark in the upgraded Red Archer. It's now the same car pretty much as the Midnight. Oh, and he misses out by half a tenth. And his teammate Alex Cooper comes across the line and takes third still. So it's Lucas Euler on pole position again. And thank you for the intro, Simon. Good to be back in Super League, but in the commentary.
Yeah, switcheroo of the old CT positions. But, yes, this could well end up like some kind of pub joke. We've got an Englishman, whatever you are, and an Irishman popping in at the same time. So it's going to be interesting. But Lucas Euler we've got then, taking yet another pole position with a 1:10.406. Chalk that up on your boards if you want to have a go for that. Red Archer splitting the Midnights, though, with OJ Clark second, just 47 thousandths of a second behind. Alex Cooper third, less than a quarter of a second of his teammate, and Dave Carr-Smith for Green Stripes Racing. James Shepherd for Hawkeye. Rude Heestbeek for Renijo Racing, Simon Cattell for Curno, Tom Parker for Woods, Powell Lignovsky for Nordgen, and Drake Racing's Keith Story rounding out the top 10 of this 23-strong field currently at the moment. Any surprises as you look down the grid there, Lee?
Yeah, just a quick shout-out for Keith, actually. I'm really happy he just got that last lap in, because he looked like he had a pretty poor qualifying session up to then, because I know the pace he's been capable, because I've been testing with him in the last hour or so, and he's just pulled it out the bag on his last run there to get into the top 10, and I think that's the first time he's been in the top 10 for a while now, actually, in that drag. So great job, Keith, really happy for you there, mate, to see him doing well. Obviously my ex-teammate as such, still helping him out in the spare time, like, obviously not just left him all to shutter, but definitely surprised that session's got to be OJ Clark, I would have thought. I know the car's pretty good now, but he's really come on strong this season, hasn't he, since he got the steering wheel set up. He's really showing what he can do.
Nice to see. Always good to have other people popping up and giving some good results. And with the dregs there in 10th and 12th, they're certainly dregging all the dregs out of the system. Philip Cullen is our race director, stroke third commentator with his multiple octopusy hands. Any surprises or anything that we should know about this track and the general racing session that's going to be taking place for us today?
Well, I have a little bit of first-hand experience from last night, although not much after I blew my engine through turn 7 with a double downshift, but it's a pretty tight circuit. I mean, you wouldn't think it looking at some of the corners that are actually fast and sweeping, but it's very hard to find yourself a good overtaking spot around here. I found that especially hard last night. Now, once you get in behind someone, it's hard to stick a car down the inside or find yourself with enough space to actually get through someone, so it's going to be a tight one. And I hear a lot of people have been complaining about tyres. I found even last night now, even when the Super Cup car, that we actually seem to be burning through tyres a bit more, so it'll be interesting to see how many stops people make tonight.
Wow. So, Lee, you've obviously been busy behind the scenes helping out with other drivers and so with the strategy, and as Phil was saying, tyres are being munched up like some kind of fatty, i.e. myself, on some kind of barbecue crawl in summer. How many stops would you suggest?
To be fair, I wouldn't really like to say. We haven't done much strategy. I only basically...
Covering yourself there.
yeah, in some respects. I basically only got the mod again an hour ago because I uninstalled it a while back to try and find out why I was off the pace this season. We seem to have found it as such. But I've just been helping Keith out a bit, and I'm not quite sure what he's opting for, to be honest. We basically worked on getting his pace better because he was struggling, and he improved that quite a lot. As you can see, he's in the top 10. The tyres, as Phil says, and that's a good point, it was the left front for me that I noticed was absolutely diabolical, the wear on it, and obviously it's a right-handed predominantly track, and it does wear out that right front, the left front quite a lot. So I reckon three stops, to be honest, because it's the super soft tyres, it's a very short pit lane, so three stops for me, I'd probably go.
Of course, this is a 70-lap race. For those of you who like the stats, damage multiplier set at 75%. Everything is disallowed except for, auto clutch. And of course the championship's very much sorted out in the constructors' facilities, because our little friends at Midnight Racing have already sealed that one up. But the Drivers' Championship, a little less so in the way of being sorted, with Lucas Oil on 149 ahead of Nick Rowland, who's not here today. Dave Carr-Smith on 86 ahead of yourself, Lee, sitting there pretty in fourth. So for being off the pace in fourth position, you've not done too bad. James Shepherd, Ruud Heesterbeek, Simon Cattell, Joe Consiglio, Yanni Daskinen, OJ Clark, the 10th position slot of the 35 drivers who have taken part so far from the 13 teams. So we're just moving forward to the actual warm-up itself. So what would you say are going to be the main challenges aside from the tyres out here today, Lee?
Main challenges of this circuit, it's a very let's say mentally challenging circuit, because it's just, there's no rest. You know, it's one corner after another. You only get the long main straight on the front. But the middle sector is very challenging. It's also quite physical, to be honest as well. I noticed driving it earlier, as daft as it sounds, it was really a physical effort as well to get it through them high speed corners, especially if your car's not quite got the upgrades that some of the others have. You tend to get a bit more understeer on the front end when you chuck it in. And that gives you a lot more work to do with the wheel, and it just feels a lot stiffer when you're turning the car. So I did find it quite physical earlier. I'm sure a lot of the drivers are also getting that too. That and obviously managing the tyres is going to be the big issue, as Phil alluded to. Obviously, the tyres wearing as well as they are. I mean, I actually think a minute ago, actually, I said three stops, but it depends how good your car is with the tyres. You might end up doing four stops, to be honest. Like when you said it was 70 laps, we have seen four stops at places like Hungary before, and that was 70-odd laps, so we could see some three and four stops. I don't think we'll see two, though.
Too risky. Of course, you can join us in the action, of course, by popping over to the simrace.tv chat room, where myself and cameraman extraordinaire Simon Melhuish, who brings you all of our pixelated glory to your feasted eyes, sitting there awaiting for everyone to put down their smutty comments. You can also tweet me at SatoriMum and at GPVWC, although I'm not sure anyone's manning that live. It'd be interesting to see exactly what people are talking about as we go. And yeah, I'm quite looking forward to this one. Well, it reminds me of Hungary, the circuit, for some reason. I know Zandvoort was here first, but yeah, this always reminds me of like a bouncier, more tumbly Hungaro ring.
Yeah, I'd actually, that's a pretty good assessment. That's what I actually felt like last night, and even used my Hungary setup as a baseline. And I suppose even Hungary's probably a little more neutered these days, because you've got a bit more runoff. While this Zandvoort we have here, you've got really no margin for error. You know, you get yourself wrong, put one wheel on the grass, and you're off. And not only that, you're not only going to hit a wall, but you can come back out onto the track and end up hitting into someone else. You know, you don't have the room to maneuver if you get it wrong. So we could easily see an issue. I was always worried last night that with the cold tires and those first few corners, it's very easy to have a pile up and maybe a restart. So hopefully we're not going to get anything like that tonight now.
I did see actually in the driver chat, which you get in R Factor, in case you don't know what game we're all watching, people were saying turn one's going to be a nightmare, so they may be self-prophesizing. Hopefully not, but we'll soon find out.
Well, Dave Carr-Smith getting quite aggressive there. Anyone who leaves the server will be shot. So that's a severe warning to that. I suddenly don't want to leave the server, so I don't know about you.
Wrap it in headlights.
Yeah.
So, just a couple of minutes left until the warm-up pops to an end. And before we take you round on the warm-up lap for the grid, I think it's a time where we shove our, well, money where our mouths are. Although I'll be talking for the most of the 90 minutes to come. Who are we going to go for?
You can go first.
That was my only gambit of being the lead commentator, yeah, to get everyone else to go first. I'm going to say that we're going to have a double Kerno top 10 finish. That's my shout for the day.
All right, so we're not necessarily going for the winner as such then.
No, I'm going to go for the underdog, that one. But no, okay. Any predictions at all?
Excellent. Keith Story, top 6. That's my prediction, and I reckon OJ Clark will give Euler a good run for his money up front.
Oh, no. I'm actually going to say Alex Cooper. I think there's an outside chance. I mean, I know he hasn't probably got a lot of testing because, from my understanding, it was a late call-up, but he spent a lot of time in that car, and let's be fair, the lads, well, he's won 4 or 5 races in a row in the Super Cup, so confidence got to be high. I'd be interested to see if he can actually give Lucas a run for his money now today.
Well, I say we're fully fed with that. I feel a bit main. I didn't go for a winner. I think I'm gonna go for OJ Clark then. I think Lucas Oil has had his fill, considering he's sitting up top on the championship. Give some of the other guys a go.
Yeah, I think Phil's shout as well of Alex Cooper's, that's a very good call. Obviously in Super Cup, he's won the races. You don't know the calibre of the driver specifically when they're not racing side by side with someone like Euler, let's say, or Clark even, or Carl Smith and Cheshire. Obviously we've seen him win the last 4 or 5 races, like you say, in Super Cup. He's coming to this and put it on third on the grid straight away, and only a few tenths behind Euler and Clark. So yeah, definitely a wild card, an outsider, let's say, for the victory.
And the old famous R-Factor announcer has announced that we're all off to the gridaroo. And that will... I do hope they keep something similar like that for R-Factor 2. I've still not mucked about with that. And Kieran Ryan has already left the server. So that's one down already before we've even got round the formation lap. So drama llamas before we even get going. Down to 22 as the field get round on the formation lap. Take you down the grid. Lucas Oil then has pole position once again for the Midnight Motorsport team, alongside him OJ Clark for Red Archer. Third will be Alex Cooper for Midnight Motorsports, and alongside him Dave Carr Smith for Green Stripes Racing. Fifth on the grid, James Shepherd for Hawkeye. Rude Heastbeak for Nijo Racing for Green. Kono Sports, Simon Cattell running in seventh position on the grid, alongside Tom Parker for Wood Racing. And Pavel Lenovsky in 10 for Nordson, 9, and Keith Storey for Drake rounding out the top 10, ahead of David Junt for Red Archer, and a second Drake of Ken Liebear for Drake, of course, in 12. Take us through, Lee.
There's Mark Wakes in 13th position, just behind the Drake of Ken Liebear. For Kerno Sport, David Stanton in 14th position, the two constants together actually on the grid, his teammate right behind him, Mark Stanton. That's one thing we've seen all season actually from the two constants. They tend to be very close together on circuit throughout the qualifying and the race.
A constant.
Mark Fuller just behind them. Sorry?
A constant.
Yeah, very good, very good. Mark Fuller just behind them in 16th position. That's Vin... I cannot say that name, I do apologise. That's Vinod Moodley in 17th position. Jeff Bean, 18th position for ST Racing. Andres Pesto is making his debut for Nordson Racing in 19th position. Chris Williamson, 20th position for Nijo. Christoph Lichtenstein, 21st for Green Stripes Racing. He had a great race last time out, I believe. Wesley Morris, 22nd for the Synergy Team Motorsports. I don't believe he set a time in qualifying. And that rounds out our top 22. And we're nearly at the end of the formation lap.
Well, hey, they are indeed. Good luck to Pestovs for his debut. Always good to see new names popping up in the Super League. I wonder if it is actually Petrov, Roldins and Pesto. We will never know. We will never know. Some other people have had monkeys. I believe I've raced against Adrian Sutil once. So that was an interesting experience for myself. As the back of the field starting to get themselves all closed up. Nice tight formation lap. Just Morris there just plodding around at the back, warming up his tyres.
Yeah, it's been very clean formation lap, and the lights are about to come on.
They are indeed. Morris just popping into his place. Look at how Clark and Euler actually very close together on the track itself. And here come the lights, and the Dutch Grand Prix is away. And look at one of the midfield cars they're sweeping out across. It's one of the Nordzone cars they're bashing up, and through goes Euler. Carl Smith up into second, battling through on Shepherd, and someone else is off. That's Keith Storey off the track. And who's that? That's a neat ST Racing of Mark Fuller off into the gravel, and I think he may well be out. Mark Stanton in trouble too, smoking all over the shot, as is Chris Williamson. Pestovs is off, Moodley's missing a wing, Stanton's upside down in 21st position, and Wesley Morris has stopped too. So drama llamas out front, but currently it's Euler, Carr Smith, Clark, Shepherd, Cattell, Heastbeek, Cooper, Parker, Lochnowski and Junt, your top 10.
Yeah, it was a crazy start. There's lots of cars there with damage, but no retirement so far. Unfortunately, Keith, like you say, taken out at the back. We've got Moodley, Williamson. Well, Williamson's at the back, but he's still got a front wing on. Unfortunately, we're out of retirements. We won't get a restart for these guys, so they're just going to have to make it back round to the pits to get a new set of tyres and wings. As you say, Dave making a superb start. He nearly had the momentum to get the lead into turn one, but just couldn't get the inside line. Oliver cut him off at the last second. Clark also had a very, really good launch off the line, and it was side by side with Oliver into turn one, but Dave Carr-Smith went through the both of them.
Good indeed, and in such a short space of time, actually, before they get down to turn one, because it's not the longest of runs, but it is Oliver there passing and completing lap one, well clear by six tenths from Carr-Smith. Clark, Shepherd, Cattell, Heisterbeek, Cooper, then down to seven, but caught out in that turn one melee slightly, then Parker, Luknowski and Junt, and a big gap back to David Stanton, who then has got Mark Wicks and Kenny Leibier all over the back of him, having half a look. Jeff Mead and Lichtenstein having a good old scrap too, but OJ Clark onto the back of Carr-Smith, and he's looking like having a half a run through as they pop over the top of the hill. Such a little roller coaster track, this one. Very, very difficult to overtake, because you need to have the right momentum to get into the right position for the right sorts of corners, because some of these corners you cannot go two by two through. And Carr-Smith placing his car in all the right places. Wesley Morris did indeed retire from that story, and Stanton are into the pits, as is Moodley, and Fuller is still trying to make his way there. So that's the four pitters and the one retirement so far.
Yeah, Clark looking like he desperately wanted to get past Carr-Smith, and as soon as he could, obviously you can see Euler in the distance. But he was putting a gap in the middle of the sector, but Dave seems to have closed it back up now somewhat through the middle sector. For the final sector, it's only 9 tenths. And obviously, as you mentioned, that Alex Cooper now in seventh position, right on the back of Heisterbeek. He's going to be making a move. He's going to make it before turn one. He's already alongside coming out the final corner. This is for P6. He has to dip back in for a second, helping the slipstream. This time, will he launch it down the inside? No, Heisterbeek once again outdoes him on the brakes. That's twice now. So Cooper being a little bit cautious on his debut here, and you can't blame him for that. He's up in the top seven at the moment, but he got singled out in turn one, basically, and lost a few places, but he'll regain that momentum. The podium's still there, just in front of him.
Kenny Leibier just got round Mark Wicks for 12th position by going round the outside of him into turn one. An excellent move there, nice and clean too, as the rest of the field continues to stream through. So we've already had the field segregate out into two very distinct groups, and it's separated by basically the top 10, covered by 6.7 seconds, then already a 3 second gap back to David Stanton, and then the rest of the field following through. Fuller and Stanton have already gone one lap down, but they have rejoined with their repaired cars. And Lucas Euler has got the gap pegged at exactly a second between Carr-Smith and Clark. And then you've got this little scrap between the Hawkeye, Kerno, Nijo and Midnight Motorsport car. And Tom Parker, they're getting a little bit closer onto the back too. But Cooper's the one, as you say, looking the most menacing so far on the back of Rude. He doesn't want to get Rude out of the final corner, but he may well have a go down to turn one.
Yeah, we saw last lap round, he had the exact same position. He needs to brake later into turn one. Once again, he backs out a bit too early, but Heisterbeek's gone wide, and that's given Cooper the slingshot, but I don't think he'll get it because you saw the camber. But,
Moodley,
yeah, his lag is terrible, isn't it? But Cattell as well, I was going to mention, up in fifth position, halfway in the back of James Shepherd. He's come back strong this race. I'm not quite sure if that car's had a lot of upgrades for this race, but the last few races he's been struggling to get near the top ten. He's now up in fifth and really looking to get past Shepherd. Obviously Cooper's still on the back of Heisterbeek, definitely trying to get past as well, but the gap up front is coming down. Carr-Smith is catching Euler again, and Clark's hanging on to him. Now I expect Clark to be slightly nervous at the moment, to be honest, because this is Clark's first real opportunity, let's say, to go and take a possible race win. At Monza he was competitive, but didn't really get the brakes, but obviously it's a unique circuit. This is the first proper circuit we've come to, and he's got a chance to win, so I'd expect him to take a few laps to settle down yet.
And it's all about getting into a rhythm around the circuit and almost becoming zen-like as you take one corner at a time to make sure that you have sheer confidence and momentum in exactly where you're going, because as soon as you find yourself wrong-footed for one corner, it really unsettles you for the next sequence, because they're all having a impact on the next one. Cooper much closer this time. Is he going to keep his foot in? Yes, he is. He's been much more forceful, but Heisterbeek just runs right, rings round the outside, still side by side as they come round into turn two. Cooper's going to have the inside line here. Heisterbeek keeps to the outside, running onto the grass. Is he going to stick one on the inside? So close. Just a hair's breadth between them, but Cooper up into sixth position. Ballsy move there. Heisterbeek down to seven. Tom Parker for Woods Racing. Nearly getting Wood there, thinking he can get up into seventh position, but unable to do so. And Heisterbeek recoups and keeps seventh position for the time being. But Parker now looking like the next one who wants to make a move.
Yeah, Cooper needed to do that. He needed to get past Histerbeek. He was being held up, and now he can get after Kittel. But you saw into turn one, something I was going to mention a minute ago, actually. If you do run deep into turn one and someone's up the inside, sometimes you can hold onto the position on the outside because the corner is very cambered, so it gives you a good, you know, acute exit from the corner. So, I was looking at the battle for a second, actually. That was hotting up a second ago. But yeah, you can get a good exit off turn one, and you can regain your position on the exit just as Histerbeek did, so we need to look out for that into turn one, that's for sure.
Christoph Lichtenstein in 14th position has just passed Jeff Mead for ST Racing, and he's now falling into the clutches of Andrei Pestovs for Nordzone Racing, all at the battle further down in the old midfield, as, yeah, you can see AJ Clark has eaten in to Carl Smith slightly, but still nothing doing for them at the moment. And Kenny Leibier having a go in 12th position at David Stanton. Mark Bicks has kept right with them as well. So all looking juicy there. In fact, Leibier all over the back of Stanton as he's trying to get past the constant racing car. And that's the closest trio on track currently at the moment.
Yeah, it does feel very strange commentating on this group of cars. Obviously, having raced with them for the last 2 years or something. I haven't actually had the chance to commentate on them, so it's very strange watching them race and not being involved in it. But at the moment, it looks like we've got a great scrap at front, because Euler is not getting away. We've seen this recently. He hasn't been able to extend his gap as he normally does. And we've got three cars battling for the lead. Shepherd hanging on nicely now as well in fourth position. He's pulled the gap on Kittel. Cooper's right onto the back of him straight away, so Cooper's taken a good second out of Kittel straight away. So we definitely need to keep an eye on fifth and sixth position over the next lap or two.
Oh dear, Kenny Leibier going too deep for his 11th positions. Got through, Stanton's having to go back round again in this little scrap. But Leibier gave David Stanton, I don't know if we had it on our screens, a little tap on the left, right rear. And it was a bit cheeky, but it was in the right place to basically wrong foot Stanton and get through. And who killed Kenny? It may well be himself down into turn one, but he's got the position just about. Oh, Stanton scared off the road and Mark Wicks trying to get through. Again, they're doing the Morris side by side out of one to try and keep it into two. And he's taking your advice. He's up there and through. And I can see that one running and running as the lead quartet starts to close down. And you can see Cooper onto the back of Kittel for 5 and 6-2. No one really getting away, but no one really stamping their authority all over this either. So I think it really is going to be one of those races that will run and run and run. And it's going to be like a strategic high-speed chess. Cooper very much clinging onto the rear now of Kittel. Oh,
and he's gone past.
Nice one.
Yeah. He did just let him.
He could be playing the long game there, obviously. We mentioned a minute ago, tyre wear and so on. Could Kittel be on a different strategy? We've seen him do this before where he's on different strategies.
Kenny Leibier is off the track and out of the race, I believe. He's gone off. Oh, that was a massive accident there. If we can get a replay of that, he just lost it. Oh, he got collected by David Stanton there. Leibier goes out wide. Stanton then just collects him because Leibier smacks the barriers. Poor old David Stanton just caught out. Leibier up into the air. Flames. Disaster. Well, I did say just beforehand, who killed Kenny? It was certainly himself. He's out of the race. That's the second retirement. And poor old David into the pits.
Yeah, I think that's actually a good example of what I was talking about in... before we got going, is that when you make a mistake, you can easily just get caught, someone else can get caught up, and suddenly a simple spin is suddenly turned into a retirement and some heavy damage on that drag car.
David Junt and Pavel Luknovsky for 9 and 10 battling side by side. The second of the Red Archers. Junt not quite on the pace of Clark here today, already 13 seconds the gap between them, but Luknovsky the lead Nordzone at the moment, however you're meant to say that. It sounds suspiciously foreign to me. So I don't know if everyone can see Junt's car. We may be having some graphical issues with that, but that's unfortunate because David is doing a nice little joint in 10th position. Is he close enough to have a go at Pavel? Not sure. He's getting into the slipstream. Pulls out. He's sling one down the inside. No, Luknovsky's got it covered, but at the risk of some tyre wear as he runs out very, very wide. Junt may be able to sling one up the inside into two. No, Luknovsky's got it covered for the time being.
Yeah, just that a quick check on the leader's lap time. Sorry there, Si. Lucas Oily, 11.549 his fastest lap. Dave Carsmith in second, 11.569. And then OJ Clark, 11.563. So they're matched by literally... 5 thousandths of a second between all three of them, and they just sat on each of us gearboxes at the moment. Now obviously we don't know the strategies as such, but Euler looks the most sorry, the least comfortable of the three. He's sliding it backwards into the corners, the back end's coming out, he's on the power too early sometimes. He looks like he's really having to fight the car as opposed to drive it nicely how we used to see him. Whereas Dave just seems content to sit in second position, and OJ quite content to follow at the moment.
I tell you what I will say of OJ's times, looking at them, is that between him and James Sheppard, their drop-offs in terms of times lap after lap is not quite as significant as, say, car Sniffs and Oilers, because they're already running a second or so off of their fastest lap times, whereas Sheppard and Clark, although Clark that time by was a second off, Sheppard is much more consistent, and he may well be wheeling them in quite soon. He's 4.9 off the leader at the moment, but yeah, it'll be interesting to see exactly how that plays out, because obviously we were saying beforehand about tyre wear and how obviously that's going to translate to more stops, but it's also going to translate into drop-off of time. So all about being touchy-feely with your tyres.
Well, Sheppard, you wouldn't put Sheppard being so far off in qualifying to where he was today. Maybe he hasn't as much practice, but my bet is Sheppard is going for one less than the guys in front of him. Because we often see from Sheppard, he always runs one less stop than everyone. So we could basically see Sheppard need to play later on in the race, whereas these guys up front maybe using their pace now, trying to get away on a three or four stop. Sheppard could be on a three stop, two stop. We don't know at the moment, but my outside bet for the race is Sheppard, that he's going to be on the prime tyres, the harder tyres, and he's going to go longer.
I was going to cut in there on your but yeah, I was going to agree with you there about James. That with the exception of Spa last time out, he's actually gone with a different strategy. So him sitting back there is a bit of a dark horse.
And yeah, Clark Pitts, like you say. Sorry, sir.
Go for it.
I just say Clark Pitts there, so that could make sense. Clark could be on a four-stop here, which could explain his pace. And then obviously Carl Smith now moving on to the back of Euler. Very close indeed now to the back of Euler. Lucas did look like he was struggling early on, so this could be interesting on strategy. This could be all about strategy, this race. Take it now, Si.
No problem. So OJ Clark got out just ahead of his teammate Junt, who still bears he battling with Letnovsky. Off your screens, we had David Stanton and Chris Williamson having a great battle. Williamson went round the outside of Stanton in the final turn, and then only got retaken down into turn two as they were running side by side by Stanton going round the outside of him. So it's all kicking off further down the field. But no, as you say, then Euler leading from Dave Carr-Smith. Sheppard now up to third from Cooper, Cattell, Easterbeek and Parker. OJ Clark, 17.9 seconds off the leader of Euler. This is going to be critical because he needs to make up the time if he's doing more pit stops. How long roughly would you say a pit stop takes round this circuit, guys? Anyone know?
Well, if he was only, he was about 2 seconds off the lead. He's only 17 behind now, and I was just waiting for him to come across the line, which is now. So it's 17.7 the gap. Obviously, maybe a couple of tenths gain back now on the new tyres. So what we say, it's about 15 seconds for a pit stop. It's a bit like Monaco. It's a very short pit lane. There's no run. You're basically in and out straight away. This could work if he's on a different strategy. And plus now, this outlap now. And that's definitely going to help him now, because Euler had to slow down. Carl Smith's had to slow down. This will give him a second straight away. He's already took 6 tenths out in the first sector. So Clark will be in the lead on these pit stops. I guarantee if he doesn't get any traffic now, if he doesn't catch Tom Parker and Carl Smith and Euler pit this lap or the lap after, OJ Clark will be resuming the lead, because he's already gained that second back straight away.
That drama became apparent because Chris Williamson in immediately racing had half spun into one of the straights, and yeah, Euler and Carl Smith now slightly held up with that as they cross over the line, neither popping into the pits this time by. Their lap times as they cross over are 1:13.2, that was 1.6 slower there than Dave Carl Smith's fastest lap to date. The problem that OJ Clark is going to find is that he's caught Tom Parker so quickly, there's only a second's gap between them. So OJ Clark immediately, what's the gap as they cross over? 16 seconds exactly, so he's eaten into that so quickly, but he's caught Parker as a result, as Pestovs has gone around Jeff Mead for 13th and 14th positions.
Yeah, and there were no signs of the leaders pitting either. There's no pit lights on as they go through the sector beams. The lights usually automatically come on if you're anywhere near a pit stop. Euler's gone through, Carl Smith's gone through, Sheppard's gone through. Not one of them has got their pit light on yet, as Carl Smith runs very wide there. And Clark's gone through, but I think Parker's pitting this lap anyway, so Clark needed to do that. But if they were to pit now, if Carl Smith and Euler were to pit on this lap or the next lap, Clark would easily be in the lead by a second or two, I would imagine.
Actually touching on the pit stops there, you have to be very careful on the entry, because there is no line on the ground. there's only the pit lights, so I think actually Vindop was a victim of that now when he had his pit stop early on for damage, that he was back in a lap later for a drive-through. So it's another little wrinkle that the drivers need to keep in mind when they're coming into the pits, that they don't overrun that line and end up with a drive-through penalty for sitting in the pit lane.
Wow. Watch out, guys, for that as Jeff Mead exits the pits from 16th position and lets James Shepherd through very, very nicely indeed. Shepherd now just 3.2 seconds off of Euler and Carr Smith, so he's gained throughout all of this drama with traffic. And who's that in trouble? Oh, it's Tom Parker into the pits, actually, from what is now P10. So slowly, the strategy is starting to unravel itself, and it's going to be very key and interesting to see what happens. It's still Rutkowski and Junt keep going.
Just to say, sorry, Euler's pit light has just come on through this first sector. Dave Carr-Smith hasn't, and neither has James Shepherd's. And Euler looking exceptionally raggy. Now, if you watch him on board at the rear end, when he tries to put the power down, if you look at the rear wheels, they are sliding up out the corners. He's really struggling to put the power down, whereas Carr-Smith's got so much more traction and grip. And you can see Euler locking his brakes there as he head down into the slow chicane. Carr Smith's lights still not on. In fact, both Midnight Car's pit lights are on, as is Cattell's, so they are coming in very shortly, if not this lap. So Euler, if we watch him now coming around the final corner, will he veer off to the right? I imagine he will do so, and he does indeed go into the pits. Carr Smith will go through, as will Shepherd, I believe, yep. Now we need to keep an eye on Clark now. Clark will easily jump Euler. Surely he will jump Euler.
You would have thought it. 14.2 as they come out of the final turn. I'm watching Clark. He's still got Heath to beat going through. Cattell's in, Cooper's in, everyone's in for a bit of an old swizzle up. And there goes Clark through. He's already going round turn one. Euler's just exiting now behind. So Carr Smith continues on, as does James Shepherd. Heath to beat is in third, still pegging OJ Clark as Vinod Moodley has crashed out and retired from last position. So bye-bye to Moodley. Unfortunately, his retirement stack continues. Lipnowski's in. That will release David Junt, who's been stuck behind him like a bottled up cork for a while. But Ruud Heesterbeek is going to be the next one that decides what's going on, because he's keeping OJ Clark at bay, but not for much longer.
Wow. He's got to make this move, he's got to do it, and he's definitely trying it. Will he drive around the outside? He's got the grip, and yes he will, if he can get the power down, and he should be able to do this, definitely. What a move from OJ Clark, eh?
Yeah, for someone we were saying at the start of the race might be just a bit nervous and wanting to take things easy because it was the first race up this direction. He's definitely taking the bull by the horns now, and he has
Dave's in, sorry. Dave's in as well. Carr Smith's in for the lead. Shepherd goes through. Now, just sorry, quickly, I was going to say something a minute ago. The strategies, I think OJ Clark is on four stops. I believe Euler and Co. may be on three stops, because three stops, you want to be pitting around lap 14, 15, 16 possibly, and that's what they're going to, whereas Clark stops on lap 10. So we could see a difference between four and three stops.
Okay, OJ Clark then up into second position, because James Shepherd is still yet to pit. 11.5 seconds of difference between them. Heesterbeek has kept Euler behind him during all of that, and look at the way that's bottling him up into the back of Dave Carr Smith, who had lost out in that pit stop melee because Euler had better tyres, or well, had the privilege of having new rubber. Heesterbeek holds it just about over the hill, but it's looking very, very dodgy indeed, and I can imagine him probably coming in very, very soon. Carr Smith having half a look. Let's look at all the different lines that they're taking as they come around these 180 degree corners, very Estoril-esque, as they pop out onto one of the many straights, and this looks like Euler's opportunity to have half a lunge. No, Heesterbeek taking the defensive line, but this is just slowing them up further and further and further. As who's that changing position? That's David Junt and Alex Cooper as well, for 6 and 7, having a good old scrap just off your screens too. So all to play for, and Heesterbeek is the one that's going to change the game.
Carr Smith's going to benefit from this though. Look at Carr Smith, he's got the run on both of them. He's going to take both of them in one manoeuvre. He's got the inside, he's got the top speed. If Carr Smith can break it, and he has done easily into turn one, and Euler's still not past Heesterbeek, is he? No. Yeah, he gets past him in the exit. But Carr Smith, very opportunistic move there, came out the final corner, saw what was happening. He eased off in the first place, and then basically bolted out of the final corner. Great move from Dave Carr Smith.
Great opportunistic move there. Working it. Waxing lyrical, as I'd say. Shepherd still out there and only being caught by 0.2 seconds that lap by OJ Clark. Now Carr Smith to third, Euler, then Heesterbeek yet to pit, Cooper, then Cattell, Parker. Lipnowski has held off David Junt. I don't know what happened with Junt, but I thought he would try and make that move stick during the pit stops. Mark Wicks has come out in 11th ahead of David Stanton. Lichtenstein then to 13. Pestovs, then Keith Story, Jeff Mead, Chris Williamson. Mark Fuller is into the pits again for Motorsport NT Racing, and Mark Stanton is your final runner. Already two laps adrift, lap 17 just being completed by James Shepherd, who stays out again.
I've been told my prediction may possibly be wrong.
Park was off.
Wow, yeah, that was a scary moment there. But yes, I've been told my prediction, it seems to be picks as well now, I've been told my prediction on OJ Clark's four stops is wrong, and that is by Jason Muscat, I believe. Was it Jason Muscat? Yeah, Jason Muscat messaged me a minute ago. He says he won't tell me now, but obviously he knows what strategy OJ's on. Now I'm just wondering, OJ pitted on lap 10. Is OJ on five stops?
That would be nuts, surely. It's too early to do much. Maybe Phil can bring us in on that. But Tom Parker in 10th position, just while we're watching, is having a real problem with a lot of suspension. That's his third spin in four corners. I think the Woods Racing driver, who was doing so well earlier on, has clouted the wall somewhere and has maybe damaged his suspension and just cannot get it home. Either that, or he's got a wheel failure of his own hardware. But either way, it's looking like an horrible end potentially for Tom Parker as he slips down the field.
He's got a puncher with that. Right rear punch, I believe.
And the day just gets worse for Woods. Obviously you don't have Kieran Ryan starting after a disconnection on before the race even got going. This of course was a team that was a team that's actually looking so well. You know, have been scoring points in the last few races and looked like they're getting that upturn in form, and it's all gone boom today.
So, off your screens as well, sorry, that's what I was just trying to... So David Stanton's just got round Christoph Lichtenstein for 11th position. Just 12 cars on the lead lap currently at the moment, and those are the last two on it, although Lichtenstein's having to go back through on David Stanton for 11 and 12. Side by side they go, around the double 180s. And you can see our leader, James Shepherd, being eaten into by Clark and Carsmith and Euler. They're 9.5, 10.1 and 11.3 seconds off your leader. And he's only going to be held up by this battling duo that are going to be busy.
He may not
themselves.
Be though, sorry, his pit light's just come on, his pit light's just come on for the second sector. Now he switched that on himself because it would come on through the first sector if it was automatic. So I'd expect to see Shepherd peel right off this final corner now. He's coming around that, yes he does, so he is going into pits this lap. So lap 19 he makes it to. Now that is, for me, that's three stops. It's got to be three stops, unless he extends his middle stint by a hell of a long way, which he has done before. This will be three stops. Then we've got Clark. We've got Dave Carsmith right on the back of him. So Clark's been held up massively for this middle sector. I made a mistake.
Do you think now maybe James made that decision looking at the two lap cars ahead of him battling the way and thinking, yeah, I'm going to lose another couple of seconds trying to negotiate then and maybe come in an extra lap or two early to avoid that?
Well, yeah, because he's come out in fourth position, obviously, just behind Euler and co. And I believe he's on one less stop than everyone else in front of him. Obviously, we're not sure how many stops the people in front are doing. But Carl Smith's right on the back, and Clark's pit light is on again. And this was, it's 10 laps ago since his last pit stop, so this would make sense as such. Is he on five stops or six stops even? Who knows? But he's definitely doing something unique here, because this is a very early second stop as Dave Carl Smith's trying desperately to get by him.
I couldn't see six stops. That's pure madness. That would never work. Surely.
Well, if he can keep the pace up in between, who knows, but at the moment it's not working because Clark loses out there because Carl Smith pulls off another awesome move. That's two now in about five laps he's pulled out round the outside. Brilliant from Carl Smith. Nigel Mansell-esque this.
So on to the main straight they go then. Carl Smith, our new leader-elect for Green Stripes Racing, leads by just a quarter of a second from OJ Clark, who... he did not pop into the pit, so not quite sure what happened with his pit line limiter there. Maybe he was thinking, oh god, and be too busy trying to get back to actually pop in. But Euler now looking like he wants a piece of the prey. James Shepherd 9 seconds off the leaders. That wouldn't have hurt his chances at all, these trio battling away, because the more time you spend battling, the less time you spend going quickly. And then you've got Alex Cooper, Simon Cattell, Heesterbeek, Luknowski, Junt and Wicks now your top 10. As with Tom Parker, who has rejoined in 13th position and everything pointing in the right direction. Still 19 runners, with Fuller and Stanton two laps down. And just your top 12 now on the lead lap.
Yeah, when Clark came out the final corner, the reason he turned his pit light off just as he came out the final corner. So obviously he wasn't intended to pit that lap, and or this lap even, and he's not intended to pit this next lap either because his light isn't on again. So I'm not quite sure what Clark's doing at the moment, but Carl Smith looking very competitive, and he's basically driven away with this one now. He's now nearly second in front of Clark, who I don't think will pit this lap because his light isn't on. So Euler's got his work cut out to get past him. Shepherd's still in fourth position, some 9 seconds off the lead, lapping pretty much very quickly what he was doing before. Still not quite sure how these strategies are going to work out. Shepherd comes across the line, doesn't really improve on his fastest lap time. So I believe he's on the harder compound compared to these guys in front of him, because to me, Shepherd is just equally as fast as Carl Smith and the others around him, proven that in previous races. Clark's light is back on now, so Clark will be pitting this lap, I presume.
Any dramas from race control field so far, or has it all been cool quiet on the front since Vinod's drive-through?
Yeah, pretty quiet actually, apart from the first lap now. Maybe people are not really hitting the button as much anymore because of the way the system works now, but apart from really the first corner, what happened down there, there hasn't been really much otherwise. Obviously we've had a few spins on, and obviously we had Kenny Leiber deciding to implode in his drag, but that's about it. So happy days really, I suppose, from the point of view of my weekend workload right now.
Having that, and happy days was certainly the theme of the day earlier on, from what I gather, as Euler having half a look at Clark, not realising he was popping into the pits, but indeed the Red Archer racer does. That's lap 22, I think a five stopper.
Indeed, possibly. Yeah, he does sniff like that, doesn't he? But Clark pits now, but the key for him, he's got to get out in front of this battle for, like, Cooper's coming down the pit straight, he's got to get in front of Cattell at least, which he will do. Unfortunately for him, Cooper's gone by now, so that puts him out in fifth position. Cattell just coming down the straight now, so he's done the job of getting out. It's relatively clean there, he's got 4 seconds in front of him. The interesting thing now to see is how long Euler, Carl Smith and Cooper will go. We think Shepherd's on one less stop than everyone else anyway. I think Shepherd might be on two less stops than, let's say, Clark. Clark's got to be on at least four or five. At least four or five, because that's two stops now in 20 laps. Now, there's no way you could extend one to make it a three or four stopper now, because his tyres, if his tyres are getting shot that early on, he'd never be able to make it work. Shepherd, I believe, will be on the prime tyre, so he'll go a long, long way on this middle stint, I would have thought. Probably to lap 40 around there, and then basically go to the end from there, possibly. So Shepherd might even be on two stops on the prime, so he could be one to look out for later on, because his pace is very good on this prime tyre, if he's on that. That's a, again, this is total guesswork, because we're not 100% sure here.
Just looking at the way how AJ Clark's lap times deteriorate, actually, over a tyre period. He does seem to drop to about 1.2, 1.3 seconds off the pace, but at no particular speed faster or slower than any other one else. He's matching Euler's drop-off, and he's matching Carl Smith's drop-off, so it is purely he's decided that actually it must be quicker to almost do qualifying runs constantly, just to see, and just pray, I suppose, that he can clear any traffic in his way as he goes. But you run so many risks of doing something like that, because the minute you come across someone who's going to have one big, huge, hairy bum in the way that you just cannot get round, that strategy is shot to bits.
Yeah, you've pointed it out perfectly. The problem is, as well, obviously, it does smell of a driver who hasn't got total confidence that he could go out and win the race on pure pace. Maybe he's going to have to try something different to try and get himself up there. Now, he's working at the moment. He's in the top five. He's pretty much guaranteed a top four position, I believe, with his current pace. Because whatever happens, I think he'll be in front of Cooper. Unless Cooper can bring his pace up a bit in his middle stint, because Cooper's a good second down on him at the moment. He's already pulled a second back on him as Clark. But Clark, he's guaranteed a fourth or fifth place as it is. Might not try something different and go for the lead, and he's already pulled a second back, a second and a half, 2 seconds nearly back on Carl Smith for the lead. Obviously he's 20 seconds behind now, and we know it's about 15 or 16 seconds to be able to jump someone. So he's got a lot of work to do, Clark, if he wants to get in front after these pit stops, because Euler and Carl Smith had a lot of time up on him on the previous stop we've just seen. But definitely looking like three or four stops for most of the field. Still convinced Shepherd's on two stops possibly though, and going very long in this middle stint, because his pace has been, it's been okay, but not significant.
Well, we'll soon be watching the wool unravel as the race continues to clock in. We're at lap 25 of 70 currently at the moment, so we're already hitting the 1/3 mark. I'm amazed to see the amount of field spread that's actually gone on throughout this race, because we've already got three drivers two laps down, everyone that
Whoa,
he's outside.
Cooper's hit, sorry, a front wing in the track or something. So he's hit someone in the track and Nijo was spun there. I'm not quite sure it was. Was it Chris Williamson? Yeah, it was Chris Williamson that spun in the track. Ooh. And Cooper's hit it and he's lost his front wing. And this has definitely allowed Clark through now. Cooper's going to have to struggle back to pit. It's obviously not too far from his next pit stop anyway, so he hasn't lost too much. He's got a punch load on the front left, unfortunately. It's a shame for Alex Cooper. He didn't deserve this.
That is an absolute travesty, as there he is taking another trip through another kitty litter as he tries to wrestle the Midnight Motorsport car back home again and down the order he goes tumbling. Hit Cattell's gone through, Heisterbeek's gone through, Lipnowski will be potentially through with Junt, although he may have enough time to try and get in and half back out again. No, they're into the home straight, so he's going to be down to 10th position by the time he gets back out again. Not what Cooper wanted, and it just shows wrong place, wrong time. Unless you've got the reactions of some kind of Jedi Master, you is in deep shtook.
Yeah, I was just going to say, as well, your prediction before the race started was it two Kerno Motorsports in the top 10 or top 6?
Top 10.
Top 10. Well, at the moment, your prediction's coming true, because Wicks has moved into 10th position recently, and he's doing a superb job, and we were talking about him before the race, about how he always brings the car home. Maybe not always the quickest on track, and at the moment he's lapping in the 13s to 14s, so that definitely figures. He's not the quickest, but at the moment he's bringing it home and he's in 10th position, so you were spot on there with that estimation.
Well, hey, Psychic Psy, just call me that, although that's probably now cursed him, so expect a double DNF by the end of the race, surely. But it's going to be one of those races, I think, where sometimes a smart, calm head wins out over general pace, because you need to, it's like that tunnel vision where you just have to zoom in and just go, right, I've got it here, as James Shepherd makes a mistake in third position but just about keeps it on the track, where less mistakes possible wins the day. As Lipnowski and Junt continue their little battle. Junt, it's taken a while for him to get back up again, but will he make the most of it down into one? Lipnowski in deep, locking up his wheels. Jump back alongside again. I don't think he's close enough to have half a stab down into two, but he's had a half a go anyway. And the problem with half a go is that you'll have half a front wing normally left by the end of it. So David needs to take stock and just make sure that he makes a fully committed effort to make sure that that red archer doesn't end up being just a red paint splat.
Yeah, just a quick shout out to Keith Story, who's fought back through the field, back up to 14th position. I was having a great battle at the moment with David Stanton. They got very close into turn one a moment ago. And he's right on the back of him at the moment, he's head through the final sector. So Keith working his way back through the field, that's him left first lap misdemeanors, unfortunately. But he's not too far off the points now. He's still got a shout of a top 10 finish, possibly, with a few more retirements.
Absolutely, a few more dramas for everyone else, because there's plenty going on. And Story popping out to have half a go at Stanton. In fact, he's got superior straight line speed as he pops down to one. But look at Stanton trying to keep on rounding outside.
He did that lap before. Stanton did that the lap before. Very, very late on the brakes. He is very confident as well. Just a quick point out to you, something you mentioned earlier as well. You mentioned the steady head and the calmer head will win, ultimately prevail. Today, that calm, steady head could be James Shepherd in P3, because he's not raced anyone as such. He's just been racing himself, keeping himself nice and paced. And he's sitting there in third position, 9 seconds, actually catching Dave Carr-Smith for the lead. And Euler is going to be pitting this lap as well. So Euler's pit light is on, yeah, it is. So he will be pitting this lap or the next. So Euler's going to be coming in as he comes down the final corner now. He's 15 seconds in front of Clark, and thank you to Jason Muscat for pointing out that Clark has closed that gap. So this will be close now if Euler can get out in front of Clark, because this is pretty much key for the strategy to work out for both of them, really.
Yes, indeed, as Euler pops in. As I said before, James Shepherd has got much less deterioration over lap times with his tyres. He seems to be able to keep them in a steady pace much better than the rest. Euler back out. Clark is already through, though. And up into third position for Red Archer. Euler well out in fourth. Cattell just entering the pits now in fifth for Kerno. And Heisterbeek continues on in sixth, which will now become fifth position. So all looking quite nice and sweet for them at the moment, as Stanton once again continues to hold off Story down into turn one, as those two, a bit like they're tied together with a piece of string. Cattell well clear in sixth position as Junt's got round Lipnowski, and then Lipnowski pops into the pits, and that's exactly what he done last time, pretty much. And then by having the undercut in terms of tyres, kept the position, even though he's not got it necessarily on pace purely alone.
Right, Shepherd, if Shepherd's on a different strategy, he will win this race. Because he's got the track position. If you look now where Carr-Smith will come out in relation to Euler, Now Euler's a good 11 seconds behind Shepherd. Now if they're on different strategies, one less stop for Shepherd, which I believe is the case, I believe he's on the prime tyre and he's on one less stop than them, he's got an 11 second advantage over Euler, and that'd be about 9 to 10 over Carr Smith, because the gap was about a second from Carr Smith to Euler. Now Carr Smith will be pitting in the next few laps, I believe, because he usually follows in sync with Euler, and that was like a couple of laps ago. On the previous stop it was a couple of laps between them. So, and Clark, I believe, is on one more stop than everyone else around him. But we've got the main protagonists at the moment, Carr Smith and Euler, who are fighting for the lead. They're on 3, I believe. Shepherd's on 2, I believe. And then you've got Clark, who'll be on 4 or 5. So, we've got a mixture. That's what I believe, anyway. I could be wrong.
Who ate all the pit stops, I think, will be what we'll say to OJ Clark at the end of that. It's like a child going nuts in a Willy Wonka factory. But we'll soon see. Great to see all the different perspectives which all the teams and drivers have come from, as David jumped into the pits from 8th position. Cooper then released into 7th quite happily. And will Junt beat Lichnowsky out? No, he will not. Lichnowsky once again takes back 8th position, as it is now. Junt well down in 9, a very slow in lap for him. Mark Wicks all on his own at the moment in 10th place, and it's quite clear at the moment of Christoph Lichtenstein, so that will work out nicely for him at the moment. Then you've got Tom Parker, David Stanton, Keith Story, they're still battling away. In fact, Stanton ahead of Story. Pestovs is quite a way back. Then Jeff Mead, then 2 laps down, Stanton and Fuller, and 3 down now after causing multiple problems. Chris Williamson, but he's still going with 4 wheels on his wagon for Nijo.
If you look at the lap time as well as Shepherd, for example, Shepherd just broke into the 11s for the first time, 11.872, which is way faster than anything Carr Smith's doing at the moment. It's almost a second lap faster. And this is what I think also points towards the prime tyre that Shepherd's running, because I had this race with him in Turkey. Inform there's a Nordson car off somewhere, not quite sure, I believe it was Pestovs.
It was indeed, as he's hit the inside barriers and the double 180, but got back going again. No damage done either to the front wing, some amazing skill to crash and be coming out in one piece.
Yeah, Clark's got Euler right in the back of him. Euler's closed up significantly over this last lap or two, and we'll probably have a rundown into turn 1 over the 4, just quickly finish on the point I made before they make the move. I had this race with him in Turkey with Shepherd, where he ran the prime tyre, and I was quicker than him in the first few laps, and after 2 or 3 laps he was way quicker than me, as Euler gets right to the back of Clark. We'll just watch this move for third position as Clark goes to the inside to defend. He left a lot of room there, Clark, actually. I was really surprised Euler didn't cut back underneath him. Slight bit of contact there, I believe, as well.
Yeah, but going back to James, actually, this is a point I made at Monza, although that broadcast disappeared, so I can make it again and it'll sound fresh. I obviously had the opportunity to work with James for a few races when he was with us in the Super Cup, and the lad is pretty damn methodical when it comes to his setup and how he goes about doing it.
He's off the track, sorry, he's just gone off the track. He's back on, he's just lost 3 seconds though doing that. I believe he got slightly puffed there by Pestovs, who I'm not quite sure if it was a collision or anything, but when I cut to Shepherd, he was off the track on the outside. Sorry for jumping in there, Phil, but I thought that was going to be a curse of the commentators again there.
True. It's just so easy. Actually, I can make a point on that too, because that happened to me plenty of times during practice, is that you need to know your lines going through there, and you can be put off by the simplest thing. Even if going past Petchoff was a cornerback, that just plays in your mind a little bit, and just you get those sort of corners wrong, you lose so much time around here. And that's one of the big keys around here, is that you get one of those corners wrong and suddenly you've lost half seconds.
Yeah, Euler looking to move into take moves in turn 1. He does launch it down the inside. Clark leaves him some space, but will he get the cut back? And again, that's the switchback we were talking about a moment ago at the start of the race. If you use the camber on the outside as Clark did there, you can gain the position back. Euler trying everything to get past him. He's desperate to get past. He knows he's losing lap time on these fresh tyres to his rival Carr Smith, who's out on his own at the moment. 20 seconds in front of Euler now. So Clark really struggling on these tyres. And yeah, just getting back to the point again, which we will make about Shepherd. I have raced him on these prime tyres before, and you can see for the first 2 or 3 laps, if you look at everyone's lap times, for the first 2 or 3 laps, the option tyres, which Carr Smith and Euler are running, and probably Clark as well, are really quick for 2 or 3 laps. After 3 or 4 laps, Shepherd's matching him, and now he's beating them. So he's still got track position on him, even though he's been off the track. Shepherd's still in prime position as Euler gets a significantly better drive off that corner, and he's side by side down into the chicane.
Even actually just talking about the tires, and when you actually just watch OJ and you look at the lines he takes into some of the corners, you could just see how little grip compared to a fresh set of boots. I mean, watching through these last few corners, and it just looks like he just wants to turn in and just waiting for it and just keeps sliding out the opposite direction. It's got to feel horrible out there.
Well, this was crucial as well, because Carl Smith's just been in the pits, and as you see, Clark and Euler coming down the pit straight. Carl Smith just come out of the pits, and he's only 2 seconds in front, but Euler cannot get past Clark, and that's ruined Euler's chance of jumping Dave Carl Smith, because he had the fresh tyres, the fresh boots, and he couldn't use it because of Clark's, persistence in defending this second position, let's say. And Carl Smith now has the fresh tyres, and he will pull away.
A weird position for Lucas to be in this season. Usually he's either been out front or even those races where he's had to fight back, like Hungary. Oh, sorry, Cattell's off.
Yeah, Cattell is out and splattered, and that was a strange one. It just kind of came to an end and it lost its front wing all of its own accord. So out for Curno. Commentator's curse. What did I say?
Wow. Very unlucky as well. It was going really well for them guys, but they've still got Mark Wixie there. It's going to be great for him because he now was into ninth position, obviously. And Wixie could be on for a good result today, because I don't think that'll be the end of the retirement, that's for sure.
Dave Stanton then will move up into tenth position. Well, he's got Christoph Lichtenstein and Tom Parker all over the back of him. Tom Parker trying to recover from his earlier puncture. And David Stanton's had his own dramas, and Lichtenstein's just there because he's been quiet. So interesting to see how they're doing. It looks like Tom Parker's going to try and go down the outside of Lichtenstein, who's busy trying to get round. Oh, dearie me, smasharoo. And unfortunately, that did not work out well for Lichtenstein. Somehow, all three cars all in one piece. And Parker's got it all to do again.
Euler and Clark has been side by side for the previous set of corners. They're still at it. But Euler needs to be careful, because he probably doesn't realise, but Clark is pitting this lap. His pit light is on. So Clark still following this very strange strategy. It's basically, it seems to be like multiples of 11 at the moment. Lap 10, and then he went to 22, 33 now he's coming in, or 34-ish, let's say. So Clark, whatever strategy he's on, I don't think it's going to pay off in the end, because these guys have done one less stop than him already, and he's still they're still next to him, so it's not going to pay off. But Shepherd on his previous lap, in 11-7. So he's pushing on with his prime tyres, and if he can get to lap 40 plus, he is two-stopping. So Shepherd at the moment, and 11-6 that time round, so Shepherd, if he doesn't pit in the near future, Shepherd is going to win this race. Shepherd is definitely going to win this race.
No pressure from him then, yeah.
No pressure, but he's on the right strategy for sure, as he always is, and as you said there, Phil, very methodical, as Clark does pit this time by, and that releases Euler, but now he's got 6 seconds to Dave Carl Smith. See how much that cost him battling there, 6 seconds, so Euler isn't going to win this race, because he's too far behind now, surely. I mean, Carl Smith had the pace on him earlier. I don't think Euler can win this race, so he has just set the fastest lap on 11-1. To me, Shepherd's in the pound seats at the moment.
Keith Story just missing the barriers for Drake Racing in 13th position. The upshot of that battle between Parker, Lichtenstein and Stanton. Stanton popped into the pits, blocked Lichtenstein's, half having a go at him down into one, and Parker passed the pair of them. Tom Parker going randomly outside of turn one on Lichtenstein in a fantastically bold move. And that's Luknowski and Heesterbeek, Cooper and Heesterbeek battling, and Cooper gets round Heesterbeek for 5th and 6th position. So that's a change there, Heesterbeek just rejoining after a pit stop. So that's net gain for Cooper now up into 6th as James Shepherd starts lap 37, 7.5 seconds clear of Carl Smith.
Well, he pitted on what, lap 16, 17 last time, so he's now gone 20 laps on these tyres. When he gets to lap 40, that only leaves 30 laps left. James Shepherd is on two stops, no doubt about it. He's on two stops. If he goes to three stops, he's mad, because he can make these tyres last, no problem. The prime tyres, he's played this perfectly. Carl Smith's catching him slightly, and his pit light's just come on now for, 35, that maybe is a bit too much, actually. If he does pit now, although I think that's an automation, I don't think that's James Shepherd's intention to pit this lap. I think that's an automation pit light, because you know when you're close to your pit stop, it cuts on. I think Shepherd will run a couple more laps yet. I don't expect to see him in the end of this lap. If he does, it'll be a big surprise, because he's got the moment, he's got the track position, he's got the strategy. If he can do two stops on the primes, that'll work perfectly for him, because there's no way they'll beat him, because the drop-off of the option tyre is just far too much to overcome the gap of a prime tyre. Over a long stint, that is, anyway. Over one lap, obviously, option's superior, but it's just not enough for a stint, and Shepherd, Oh, he does pit, so this is intriguing now. Is he... Now, will he try and go to the end? He's got 33 laps to go. That is possible.
If I was to put my money on anyone doing it, it would be him, because I know he would have done it in testing. It wouldn't be some half-hearted gamble. He'd have a fair idea if it was going to work or not.
He's going to come out about, what, 12 seconds behind Dave Carr Smith. Now, if Dave has another pit stop to go after this, which he will, James Sheppard needs to get on it now, but with that much fuel in the car and the hardest compound tyres, he'll have Hoyler, no problem. Hoyler's only 4 seconds down the road, but Carr Smith is the only one I really believe who could take it away from Sheppard now, if Sheppard is on the two-stop, which he's only got 33, 32 laps to go. That's got to be possible, like you say, Phil. He must have tried this. I mean, he's just done 20 laps on the other tyre. It's got to be possible. He's got to risk it, surely. I mean, it's worth a risk.
Why not? I mean, he's not exactly in a championship fight. This is a great opportunity to try and get that first victory. Oh, no, James, what are you doing, lad? Seriously, track's that way.
That's throwing it away, because the gap now to Carr Smith is 16 seconds. So if Carr Smith was to pit now, I don't think he'd come out behind him. I reckon he'd come out in front. So Sheppard might have just thrown any chance away that away. But we'll see, because the drop-off of Dave Carr Smith's tyres is yet to happen. It will be the next few laps where Dave Carr Smith's tyres start to drop off. The option compound will drop off, and the primes will come to Sheppard.
And I was actually just about to say, he's actually got a nice clean track, let's say, in relation to when Lucas came out of pits. He obviously spent so long fighting OJ. He's got James has the clear track in front of him right now. Plenty of room just to start nailing those qualifying laps for himself. He's going to need those qualifying laps now after that mistake too. As Alex and Root are still going at it pretty hard, going through the chicane. It's been a pretty good debut for Alex, you know. Considering he was dropped into this at the last minute, now obviously he qualified very high third, but to do this over a race distance, and I presume it's going to be a tricky car. Obviously, Lee, you have a lot more experience in these Super League cars than myself, but it's not probably the easiest thing in the world to go from Super Cup to Super League. Lucas went down to Super Cup last night to fill in for CSG. Very similar circumstances in the very last minute, and you know, there's the championship leader, and he was only 8th fastest in qualifying and had a difficult race. Now, wasn't all his own fault. There was a lot of issues with other drivers, I believe, from what I heard, but still, it's a big ask to step up, and Alex obviously doing himself no harm.
Yeah, the Super Cup, to me, is the harder car to drive over the Super League, but the only reason that is because I think the Super Cup is easier to set up than the Super League. The Super League is very, very dependent on setup, on car setup. You get a good car setup, you'll go well. And that's the biggest difference. I don't think it's the driver as such. I think it's down to a lot of knowledge, and that's probably, like you say, where Sheppard can come into his own, and people like that were very methodical, and the people who've done that this year have really shown themselves to be a lot better driver than maybe they'd look in something that's not so setup-based, let's say, something where it's pure driver. That's not disrespecting anyone as such, obviously. It's just saying that if you've got a methodical mind, and you can really overthink your opposition as well, which is a good advantage to have. Possibly Sheppard's done that today.
Oh, I don't take that as a thing. I know I'm dirt slow in this car. No matter how much I try when I was testing it.
Ooh, here comes Easter Beak, sticking his beak right in there into turn one. Takes position. Sorry to cut across. I was getting all excited. So then EJ pop into the top five, and Rude not needing to be rude, he just stuck it right on in there.
Yeah, and also a thing to point out, Alex Cooper's race was slightly destroyed, let's say, when he had contact with the other Nijo car, actually, which is obviously been battling at the moment. Histerbeek's in the Nijo. His name is Chris Williamson. Did his teammate a favour in some respects, because Histerbeek's now gained from Alex Cooper losing his front wing earlier. Not saying in any way that was done on purpose, of course, but just unfortunate. He's putting 43 seconds behind, 55 seconds behind Dave Carr Smith now. So Alex Cooper's debut race didn't exactly go to plan, but he's equipped himself well, let's say.
So if he was to get signed up for gpvwc.com and get yourself in on the action, where would you guys to signpost people to first to get themselves onto this career ladder? Because it's such a fascinating league to take part in, with all of the little quirks and uniqueness that you've got as Cooper pops into the pits now from sixth position. Where would you pop people to first?
Well, the first thing I'd say, sorry, is that if you're going to join a league now like this, it's no longer a league where you turn up and have a laugh, let's say. There is still the fun element to everything. There's always got to be. You know, there's the community aspect as well. You've got to have things to roll and work. But the biggest thing now, if you do turn up to a league like this, you've got to have, and I can speak for that for myself as well, you know, from this season for me has been a disaster, and the reason being is there just hasn't been the team there like Midnight. I mean, it's not just one person, it's not just Euler driving that car or Nick driving that car. It's a whole team behind them, you know what I mean? And it's the same with Shepherd, he has the people behind him, he'll know what he's doing, he'll work with people closely. You've got to have people that know what they're doing, that Phil alluded to a bit ago as well, and I'm sure he'll back this up in a minute, that are methodical in thinking. They can think every single aspect over of a setup, a strategy, a tyre compound, a drop-off, a lap time, a stint, everything. You've got to cover every single aspect to be able to win. Not only in this league, there's leagues all over the world like this, you know, all the top leagues. And GPWC is now a top league. It's no longer a league where you can turn up and have a laugh and win races. You've got to think to win.
Yeah, definitely. I've been around this community for quite a long time, actually. I've been in and out of it since 2005, and just to see where it's come, especially now over the last 2 years. You took a hiatus now a couple of years ago and came back last year. And obviously, you look at the level of drivers in here now. You know, years ago, you could get away with being slow, let's say, in the Super League, or being half-hearted. But these days, you can't. And you really need to come in and put the effort in. Even if, you know, you have guys here who, you look at those guys, I always tip my hat to the lads who don't score points, but just keep showing up week in, week out. You know, that's probably one of the toughest things to do. You know, racing a race knowing you're not going to win, but you're not going to have a chance at points. And to be able to show up like that, that takes some sort of dedication to be able to do that, and to be able to keep your momentum, keep up your commitment and your desire to just put a car around the track knowing that. And that's what we're getting at now, not only at the Super League level, but now at Super Cup. You look at who we have there. We've got top teams who could very easily race in the Super League, racing in it now. And hopefully, obviously, we'll have the Formula Challenge next year nearly as strong. So, yeah, we do want people to come and have fun. But at the same time, you do need to be serious about it. You do need to be able to come here and say, right, I'm going to put an honest effort into doing this sort of stuff.
I'd always put in an honest effort. My honest effort would probably get me 26th on the grid, but I'd always have a good old giggle and a good insertion into the community. That wasn't the word I was looking for, it's just the word that was on my tongue at the time, apologies. But, no, always a good place for a community event, as Pavel Luknovsky pops in from what was 7th, already down to 8th as Junk goes through, doing his old undercut again, and it's worked for him on the previous two stops. He'll be hoping that it works again with him against David Junt. James Shepherd in a bit of traffic at the moment as he negotiates Keith Story. And 15 seconds behind Dave Carr-Smith. That's pretty much coming up to a pit stop. This isn't quite over yet.
I mentioned while we were talking as well that Euler did pit for the third time. So it looks like he's on four stops. So Euler did pit for the third time. So I think Euler's on four stops. Dave Carr-Smith, I believe, will follow him in shortly. Shepherd's still in a good position. He's come out obviously 12 seconds in front of Euler. The gap is about 16 seconds. It keeps going up between 15, 16, 17 every now and again to Carr-Smith. I think when they, each respectively catch a bit of traffic. But the last time round, Carr-Smith, his time's dropped off a little bit. He did a 13.0, but he's back down to low 12s again now. The only problem is that Shepherd is going faster than that now. So the tyres on Shepherd's car have now come to him. It's taken four or five laps, but Shepherd's tyres have come to him. And now he's starting to claw the gap back to Dave Carr-Smith again. And if he takes another second out of him, as you said a minute ago, he might come out in front of him in the final stop. Now, I don't know if he'll be able to hold him off if he has that such of a gap, but it depends how many stops they've got to make. I believe Euler's got to make one more stop. I think Dave Carr-Smith's got to make two. Although it depends how long he can make this go, because if he keeps going the way he is, maybe he's only got to do one more. Maybe he'll try and extend the final stint. So there's so many options available out there at the moment. I don't think anyone is on a planned strategy, apart from possibly James Shepherd, because he went to the prime tyre. So he knew he was going to be doing less stops than everyone else. I think the rest of them are just making the tyres last as long as they can, and as soon as they drop off, they pit. I think it's just taking it as it comes sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Jeff Mead in from 14th for ST Racing. Making another stop. He's the last of our two laps down guys, followed in by, who's that? That's Lichtenstein, just coming in from 11th position. He's just one lap down, just outside the points as well, so he will be desperate for someone to drop off up front. good efforts all round. And those are the kind of guys that we salute, as Phil was saying earlier on, because they're not always in the points. But they come up and give it a damn good shot. And that's what we like to see at GPVWC. And don't forget, GPVWC.com, sign yourself up, get yourself involved in the action, we're all here to help you get going.
Yeah, one thing we're not trying to do, obviously, is deter drivers who haven't got the time to put in massive effort and get a team behind them. That's the last thing we want to do, obviously, in any league, is to say, don't come here unless you're serious. Because there's guys at the back of this field right now, I mean, who will turn up just for the sake of... They want to race, they want to have a go. Chris Williamson's won. Chris Williamson, I can't remember the last time he had a good result. You know, he's very unlucky. He hasn't had a good result for a long time. I mean, a good result to Chris, he enjoys racing, he'll turn up. A good result team will be finishing the race. You know, that's something you can aim for, and I'm sure it'd be first man to admit that. I'm not digging him or anything like that. But he doesn't finish, he doesn't win races, he doesn't get podiums, but it doesn't mean he doesn't try. You know, he's quite happy racing where he is at the moment. He's having a good time. Anyone can do that. You can turn up and do that still. It's not a case of, if you're not quick, you won't be able to have fun here. So we're not trying to deter anyone from what we said a minute ago.
Yeah, especially because you can get yourself into a team environment and you can make yourself better. I mean, you look back at what it was like. I was awful years ago before I actually sat down and actually got myself surrounded by some good people to be able to develop myself and to be a good race driver. I always consider myself this year as my second career here at GPVWC, because if you look at what I've done before, I'd be lucky to get a job as a sim racing driver, the amount of retirements I used to rack up. No, it's the truth. And it was because I went away and I managed to find some people that to work around, and that's really actually is a good story for how this season has gone, is that Midnight have been a great team environment, and it's shown, and it's not even just shown at this level, it's shown at Super Cup level as well, what they've done there. And you can see other teams are probably going to use that as the blueprint, and hopefully it will help that when you do have a raw rookie come in, that they're taken in under the wings by the bigger team and shown the ropes and shown how to get better and help them to become better drivers.
The first team to me who ever did this sort of scale of domination, let's say, and planning and tactics, as OJ Clark is going to pick this lap, I believe. But the first team for me is a team that doesn't actually race in GPWC. And it's called Precision Motorsports, and I'm sure everyone's heard of them anyway from all the other leagues they race in and dominate, and Bono Wees and all that lot, you probably know all the names. But they're the guys, to me, who first made everyone sit up and think, that's what you've got to do to win. And I certainly learned from what they did, let's say, a couple of years back. And it is frustrating at first, because you think, how can they be that good? But it's just a case of putting in the effort, analysing every single aspect of this, of the race, of the anything that could go wrong, you've got to know everything, you've got to have a backup plan for everything. And they were the first people to me who brought that into sim racing. I think everyone's basically like copying them from that, let's say, and working out what you've got to do. Obviously Midnight to me were the first team in GPWC to do that. They were the only team who really planned anything from last year for this year. The rest of it, everyone else just thought, oh, next year's next year. Midnight didn't think that. Halfway through last year they started planning for this, and that's why they deserve everything they get.
OJ Clark just came out from his fourth stop. That was a 12 lap gap, that one. He's desperately trying to eke out another lap, I think. I think he's realised that he's on the wrong side of the fence in terms of pit stops, and he's trying to eke out maybe an extra lap or two with each one so that he can get himself back down to maybe a 5 or a 4 stopper by the end of it. He just pops a lap on Lukanovsky. So currently on lap 49 then of 70, just a quick rundown of the order. Dave Carr-Smith leads by 15.5 seconds. Begging the gap is James Shepherd in second. Lucas Oiler 24 seconds off the leader in third. OJ Clark now in fourth after his pit stop ahead of Ruud Heesterbeek, the only other unlapped driver, in fifth. Then Cooper one lap down sixth. David Junt seven. Pavel Lukanovsky eight. Mark Wicks still going in nine, one lap down. Two laps down, Tom Parker in 10, closing him down as the Woods Racing driver. Then we've got Christoph Lichtenstein for Green Stripes, David Stanton, Constant, Keith Story just exiting the pits for Drake Racing, also two laps down. Then three laps down, Jeff Mead for ST, Andrej Pestovs, your favourite foodie in Nord Stein, Mark Stanton in the Constant after being upside down, still going three laps down, as is Mark Fuller for ST. And then four laps down, still going, Chris Williamson. Venezia, your retirement so far, Simon Cattell, Vinod Moodley, Kenny Liebeer, Wesley Morris, and poor old Kieran Ryan didn't even get out of the starting blocks.
Well, Lucas Oiler, he's not going to win this race, basically, that's it. There's no way he can win this race. He's got another pit stop to do. He's 25 seconds behind Carl Smith and 9 seconds behind Shepherd. I believe it'd be Carl. Well, if, I think Carl Smith has switched strategy as well, because he followed Euler pretty much. He was very close to Euler throughout the pit stops, like a couple of laps apart each time. And all of a sudden this stint, he's gone 6-7 laps more than Euler. If he pits anywhere in the near future, you can basically, that's his final stop done in my books. And I believe Shepherd's got one more to go as well. So I think we're going to see Dave Carl Smith, Shepherd, and not Euler. Because I think Euler's, he's got one more pit stop to do for sure. Even if he hasn't, he won't be able to hold off Shepherd and Carl Smith, and he certainly won't come out in front of Carl Smith. So I think we can discount Euler from this win now, unless he can pull some out of the bag, but I can't see it happening. His pace advantage is nothing compared to what it used to be. And I think we're seeing the result of that now, because all the other guys are catching up and they're starting to beat him, let's say. Maybe he's not putting the same effort in anymore, because obviously they won this a long time ago. They won this last year, as we were saying, basically, so with the proper planning. But at the moment, Dave Carl Smith and James Shepherd looking good for a first and a second. I believe they've both got one more stop to do, as I said. And that'll be coming up in the next few laps, I would have thought. Unless Shepherd does try and go to the end, but I don't know. I don't know if it's worth it now. The gap's down to 15 seconds, so he might come out in front of Carl Smith, but win two laps, Carl Smith will be back past him on the new options.
We have a front wingless David Jones going around, trying to find his way to pit lane. He's going the scenic route towards pit lane anyway. He lost it around turn 6 or 7 and just had to hobble back.
Wick's still going, sorry, 9th position. He could benefit possibly from this, but I think he's a bit too far behind. Wick's still going strong. He's drove a really good race, actually, hasn't he, Wick? We were talking about him before the race, and he just seems to be starring at the moment. Pretty impressive.
Yeah, this, you know, when I was talking about him at the start, or when we were talking beforehand, this is the bread and butter. He's not the quickest in the world, but you give him a car, you give him one that is reasonably good, and to be honest, that Kernow has been pretty dogged for most of the season. It's, from what I understand, it's after getting some upgrades there, as he does actually get past David Junt now, so he's an 8. But you give him a solid enough car that can get him up in the competition, and he will bring it back in the points. And it's great to see after such a difficult season. And I do hope, say fingers crossed and toes crossed, that this isn't a commentator's curse on the poor guy, because he's had his fair share of it this year. But I do hope he gets the points, because he does deserve it for the effort that he's put in. And first year, and this is his own team, it's his first time that he's had his name above the door, and it was a big moment for him. And this, if he can get these points, you know, it's going to go down as probably one of his career highlights for him anyway.
Yeah, because he hasn't scored any points, has he? He's still on zero. So this could be like a Minardi scoring a point, you know, for the first time. It, like, you know, the celebration that's going to go off here. So we really need to cheer on Mark Wicks here. He's currently in 8th position. No, he's just been passed by Junt now for that, but that's expected. He's a good second, a lap slower. But he doesn't need to fight Junt. He's still in the points, in 9th position. I bet he's, well, I don't want to use that expression, actually. I'll just say that I bet his heart's racing. Because, like you say, this would be a big moment for him. Now, James Shepherd, Dave Carl Smith's rear tyres are basically gone. He was really struggling to put the power down the middle when I last saw him, and he does pit. And James Shepherd took 2 seconds out of him on the last lap. So Shepherd will come out in front of, Dave Carl Smith's in the pit now. Shepherd will go through into the lead. But how many pit stops does he have to do? He's going to go by easily. He's gone past now. Now, the significant thing is, how far can he get in front? It's going to be a good 5-6 seconds, I would have thought. It is about 5 seconds. Yeah, 5 seconds pretty much exactly. So, will James Shepherd go to the end, or will he have to do one more pit stop? If he goes to the end, it will be a struggle for him for the first 4 or 5 laps, I believe, to hold off Dave Carl Smith, because Dave Carl Smith will just eat into that gap on the new options, because he will take a second a lap out of him straight away. But then when the options drop off, will James's old, hard tyres be able to cope and basically bridge the gap between the old the new options and the old primes? That's the thing now we've got to watch for, is the tyre drop-off. That's going to win this race. If James Shepherd, who did set his fastest lap on the last lap, were only 11.4, so he knew that Dave Carl Smith were coming in that lap. But does that mean he's at the end of his fuel and he's going to have to pit again shortly? We'll have to wait and see.
Just looking at James Shepherd's pit stops. He was last in on lap 38, or on lap 53 as it is now, so that's already 15 laps in, and his previous stint was an 18-lap stint, which leads me to believe that I don't think he'll be able to keep going all the way to the end on these tyres. I thought they'd explode and be quite pathetic, potentially, by the end of it, as the gap as Carl Smith pops over, stabling at 4.2 seconds. And I won't think it would make sense for Carl Smith to try and hang it out to the end, so it really is going to be who's got the most amount of rubber on their tyres by the end, I think. And Euler already down in third. Elsewhere, we've had Mark Fuller just pop into the pits and rejoin in 17th position, go four laps down, and keep Mark Stanton in 16th. So that battle pretty much come to an end. And everyone else pretty much spread out for the time being, although Mark Wicks has been into the pits and Tom Parker has taken 9th position for the time being. But I'm sure that will be pit stop rectified when Parker pops in a little bit later as Shepherd gets a bit wiggly out of the exit of the most recent corner.
Yeah, Carl Smith will definitely go to the end now. There's no way Carl Smith won't go to the end. So Carl Smith's done for the day. Whatever he does now, he's done for the day pit stop wise, unless he has an unplanned one. But he's going to the end, whatever happens. So he's got track position on Euler, so Euler's not the threat now. And I believe Euler's got to stop again, so there's no way Euler will win this race, like I say. Shepherd, like you say, it would be unlikely that he can go that far. I mean, it is a stretch, but and especially the fact that even though I said the prime tyre, the harder tyre, he's off the track. He's back on, but he's lost a bit of time there. That's cost him. But yeah, the prime tyre on these red stripe banded tyres is only the soft tyre. It's not actually a harder compound as such. It's slightly harder than the super soft. Still not much better, so I don't think they'll go that far. His pit light just comes on now, so unfortunately it looks like Shepherd is going to pit. But the key for him now, well, he will get back out in front of Euler because Euler's got to stop again. So yeah, it's going to be Carl Smith, Shepherd and Euler, I believe, the top three.
Yeah, Euler pitted in lap 43, so he may not be in for another couple of laps, which will give Euler a staggered position two for the time being. But I think actually that yeah, you're right, Euler will be in. So, James Shepherd, it's been great while it's lasted with that B1 next to his name for Hawkeye, but unfortunately it looks as though he will be popping in and ending that soon. You can see just the sheer amount of time that Carl Smith is eating in, partly due to that mistake of James where he ran off the track. 2.4 seconds the gap, he keeps to the inside, in he does pop. Hawkeye racing car, re-locking up of the old brakes. As Phil said, there is no specific line there. You've got to use your own visual point. And that could be something that may cause an issue for people when they are on their absolute last dregs of tyres. Here comes Euler. And Shepherd will come out behind for the time being. Let's see what Euler can do.
Yeah, Euler's got to stop again though. So yeah, Euler's lights on now. So Euler's pitting this lap. So Shepherd will regain second position. Got 18 seconds to Dave Carl Smith. I don't think, even with the drop off on tyres, I don't think he'll make that up unless anything happens to Dave. If Dave has a spin or something and the gap comes down to say 5 or 6 seconds, then Shepherd's got every chance because we've seen the drop off that Carl Smith gets on them option tyres as opposed to the prime, which I believe Shepherd's running. And also that's another point for Shepherd. He's still done one less stop than everyone else, so he's definitely tried it. And you know, even with the mistakes he's had, take another 5 seconds away from that, he'd only be 12 behind now. I mean, he could have won this today if he had a bit more of a break at the beginning, possibly. He did get stuck behind a few cars and so on. So Shepherd did have the strategy today to do, you know, he's going to get second position, which is not a really bad result in some respects. I'm not trying to downcast him in his result, but he definitely had the pace to challenge for that win today and just showed that a different strategy can do something. Clark, in the meantime, has just fallen off the back of this. He will jump Euler actually now, so Clark will come out in front of Euler now in third position, but I believe Clark has got at least one more stop to make. Who knows, he could make 10.
Chris Williamson, Andrzej Pestovs, and now Alex Cooper into the pits and exiting back out again. So they're just making their final stops of the day. Still 18 runners running in this Grand Prix around the old circuit of Zandvoort, in case you've not quite recognised it as being a new local one. Chris Williamson's gone five laps down. I'm just seeing where he was in relation to our leader, because he seems to be involved in quite a lot of the half spins where he gets caught out by other guys and taken out. He's like an unguided missile. He may take some twist on the race before it comes to an end. But yeah, as we come into the closing stages and we see what's going on, has this race so far lived up to expectations, or has it been not quite been this high speed game of chess that we were thinking of?
Oh, definitely, it's been a race of strategy. Definitely. I mean, it's kept us guessing, hasn't it? I mean, we're still not 100% sure if, you know, let's say Clark, what Clark's doing. I mean, like I say, he could pit 10 times now towards the end of the race. We don't know. That's the thing. It's really got us. The on-track action's been pretty good as well, to be fair. We've had a lot of overtaking for a track that doesn't provide much overtaking usually. We've had a lot of side-by-side action. This field's pretty sparse at the moment, let's say. It's pretty well spread out. There's still battling going on all the way down, and you know, we've got some good stories today as well, haven't we? Like you say, Wixie, if he can bring it home in 10th position, he's got Liechtenstein closing him down though for that 10th position, but if he can bring it home in 10th, that's going to be a big celebration for everyone, and everyone involved as well. We've got, obviously, Dave Carr-Smith, who could take another win. We've got Shepherd, who'll be getting a second position. Clark is in third currently. Can he use his strategy to affect still and beat Euler? I doubt it, but there's a lot of stories still to be solved, and we've still got 12 laps left.
How often has it been that a midnight race motorsport car has not been on the podium this year? Not very often, has it?
I believe. Is this going to be the first time?
Yes, I believe so, because I know Lucas was offered twice in Hungary when he finished sixth. I remember he had the issues there when he ran into someone, and he retired at Monaco. But in both those occasions, Nick had finished second and third, respectively. So there's always been a midnight on, yeah. Yeah, just checking the wiki there.
Well,
yeah.
Nick won the race, didn't he, in Hungary?
Yeah, and he finished second in Monaco then.
Yeah.
So this would actually be, if OJ was to hold it, would be the first time we do not have a midnight car on the podium. So it would be another first as well, amongst the other stuff.
That one's a long shot, unfortunately. I believe Clark, well, he will have to pit again for sure. There's no way he can, yeah, he's pitting this lap. His lights just come on, or the lap after at least. And you only have 10 laps then to claw back a 14-15 second gap, so I don't think it's going to happen, but you never know. I mean, something could happen to Euler in these last few laps, but it looks like we've got the midnight podium streak is going to continue, but that would be a feat in itself. It's going to happen sooner or later, that's for sure, because today Euler has had no advantage. Today they just simply drove around him, drove off and left him. They've out-strategized everything. He's not had the advantage that he's enjoyed for the season, and Clark's threatening him as well. Who'd have said at the beginning of the season OJ Clark would be threatening Lucas Euler for the final podium position? No one.
Well, he was in a Synergetic then, so I don't think anyone would put money on a Synergetic been up there, but obviously the change in car has helped, but obviously going to a team, because I would call Red Archer a team, because you cannot call what Synergetic are right now a team. It's a waste of space, to be honest with you, if you are, it asks me. But obviously that new environment, having a teammate to work with, and that sort of thing, to be able to go into that would re-energise you, would make you want to get up and go at it. And after what OJ had to go through at the start of this season, it's like a new lease of life for him, and fair play to him to actually taking the opportunity with both hands and going with it.
You know what though, I was going to say actually, before he even joined Red Archer, I mean obviously the team's helping him even more forward, like you said, they've pushed him onto newer heights, and he does pit now obviously, that's allowed Euler back into that third position. 11 seconds, 12 seconds, about 13 seconds, Clark's got to make up if he wants to make it a first if no midnight on the podium. But yeah, just going to point out that Clark, when he got the new steering wheel, because obviously we forget that he was a keyboard driver last year, and I think the beginning of this year as well, and then obviously he got the steering wheel, and bang, suddenly it was a lot quicker. I remember racing and congratulating him in that Synergetic, which was, like you say, a very poor car, and it has been all season. He was up in the top 10, you know, fighting for points in a car that was way behind anything else that even we had, and we were quite far behind at one point. So the wheel definitely helped OJ show his true potential. Obviously, like you say, getting into a team as well has just pushed him that extra few tenths. But the wheel definitely helped OJ show, look, this is what I can do with proper equipment.
Tom Parker into the pits from 9th position, a late one on lap 60, although he's on 58 himself. Liechtenstein also popping into the pits, and that's allowed Mark Wicks sliding through on Tom Parker to take 9th position now for the Curno car. Mick's probably, yeah, well, he pitted on lap 51, so maybe Wicks will have to pit again. Maybe he's going to try and hang it out to the end. Be touch and go. But yeah, Tom Parker now once again with work to do for the Woods Racing team, trying to go straight right around the outside. He's wasting no time with that. Wicks having to take evasive action around the outside goes Tom Parker, popping his car in all the right places. I'm so excited there was on-track action. Muffled the words, but not to worry. Wicks still in a points-paying position. David Stanton is his next problem because Liechtenstein has pitted as well on lap 57. As Keith Story also in from that 57, so the back markers just now making their last pit stops of the day, and it'll be a run home as David Junt exits the pits from 8th position too.
It is sensible from Wicks there, because he wants this point badly. He will want this. I can feel his pain, you know what I mean, for this point. I really can. I'm excited for him to get this point. I really, after we were talking about it beforehand, and everyone will be happy for Wicks to score this point. not talking like I'm his best friend or anything like that, so I'm probably not, but just basically it'd be nice to see something different, you know, something new. And Parker there, obviously, he just wants to get on with it. He's not really racing him because he's been in front of him all day, apart from that spin I think he had. But Wicks just basically, he didn't try and outbreak him or anything like that. He just said, no, go, I don't want to race you for that ninth position. I'm in a points-paying position still. That was sensible driving.
Sometimes it's much easier to let people go in a battle, or just in general, to say, right, do you know what, I'm quicker without having to scrape around your front wing. And discretion, the better part of valour there for him, as Carl Smith pops around to complete lap 61 and start lap 62. Phil, didn't get to ask you, sorry. What have been your highlights of the race so far?
Well, I did miss part of it, though. I will say I had a power cut there, so I think I missed stuff. Like, I was there talking about Alex, and I didn't realise he actually had a broken front wing. But obviously, it has been the strategy, is what Lee brought up. It's nice to see, okay, this track doesn't promote a lot of great overtaking, although we have seen some out there today. So, obviously, it falls on the strategy to give us something interesting to watch. And it's been nice to see people using different strategies. Now, we've touched on the fact that James is a big purveyor of going with different strategies now and trying something different. But even the likes of OJ, okay, it's a bit of a weird strategy that he's taken, but it's something different. And in a time when we can see people suckered into, okay, I see this guy and this guy and this guy doing this strategy, okay, I'm going to play the percentages and go with them, it's actually nice to see people going out and trying something different, to do something different, because when everyone does the same thing, not only is it boring, but you're not really going to get an advantage out of it. Okay, OJ hasn't come out on top out of this, but at least he tried it. He knows now, maybe going forward is something he can take forward with him to the next race and learn something from it and be able to do something for the next race with it. So, what else have we had? Obviously, yeah, we talked about Wixie, and obviously maybe another story to continue that is obviously Norjan again having a poor day, only one car in the points, and that's other car has really become a bit of a carousel in terms of drivers, as we see Pestov is having, Pestov, however you pronounce it, sorry, but today it's become quite a carousel, which has been a problem for Norjan over the last few years. If you look back at the who they've had, they've usually had one driver who's been around all season and one driver who's, or one car which has been rotated around. Obviously,
pay driver.
Yeah. Wasn't the plan, obviously, at the start of this year, but obviously Joe deciding he had to retire changed that, but it's caught Norjan out. They've gotten away with it up until, well, last season they didn't win the Constructors, but it's something that they've gotten away with over the last few years. But what we touched on before about the level of competition rising, you just can't get away with that sort of strategy anymore.
We've just lost Jeff Mead, who's binned it into the wall. Lost his front wing, then parked it for ST Racing. That's a shame from what was 16th position, or 15th position, as Pestov has already gone through. So a late race retirement for the ST team, which has promoted actually his teammate Mark Fuller up to 16th position. Although there was some drama early on in the race, has kept a clean sheet since. And that drops us down to just 17 runners and riders remaining. Still Carl Smith ahead of Shepherd, Euler, Clark, Heesterbeek and Cooper, your top six. And of course we've got, just as we're coming into the closing laps, a couple of tracks still left to go. We've got the Nürburgring coming up next on the 6th of September. Road America, then obviously Brazil, until Argos there I believe. Then Suzuka we're off to. And of course Singapore rounding us off on the 1st of November. Any particular teams or anything, anyone that you know of, feeling particularly confident about any of the tracks going forward? Or do you have any particular preferences to what tracks we've got coming up left to go in this calendar?
Did you say Road America?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I never knew we were going there.
I can explain that part now.
Detour.
The yeah. The US race was up on the calendar, but it was always TBA for quite a while. There's a lot of tracks out there in America, and I think some people were thinking Indianapolis for a while. I recommended Road America was one of the ones I thought. Yeah, Indy is okay. Indy, I suppose, it's a nice to say I won the Indianapolis, but the road course there, it's okay, but it's not great. So for myself anyway, it was down to a choice between Road America or Watkins Glen, and I thought the idea of going to Road America appealed to me myself, because there's, at least with that track, you've got some place to overtake. Watkin Glen, great track, but doesn't really have a lot of deep braking zones that you can really throw a car down the inside of. So I thought for single-seater racing, Road America would be a bit of fun, and it's always been a great track to drive, so it was lovely to see that selected for it.
Sod Laguna Saber. Yeah, we should do Bristol.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, well, Martinsville either, you know. Oh, yeah. You've got braking points in Martinsville, at least, because of the way that the paperclip works there.
The only reason I sound so surprised is the fact that it was tinged with excitement as well, because I think I'm going to have to find a drive now for Road America, because I can't believe we're going to be racing Formula 1 cars at Road America. That's going to be awesome.
Yeah, I mean, while we don't follow the calendar, it's nice to be able to throw in these cars that should be in a Formula 1 calendar, but they're not. Mm-hmm. So that's the one I'm actually really looking forward to myself now with Super Cup, is just to fake Nürburgring, get that over and done with, let's get to Road America.
Well, after Nordstrom's dismal day today, I might have to get in touch with him after this race.
Well, you could be the next one on the ever-revolving door of the second driver. I do notice, looking down the calendar, I did chortle to myself when I didn't see Valencia. There we go. We're just coming up to the 3 laps to go mark. Still Dave Carr-Smith leading the way by 19.7 seconds. James Shepherd, Lucas Oil, OJ Clark, Ruud Heesterbeek, Alex Cooper, Pavel Luknowski, David Junt, Tom Parker, Mark Wicks. Your scorers so far: Lichtenstein has retaken 11th position because David Stanton has had to make a late race pit stop. His pit stop slightly out of fashion after he spent a little bit of time in repair after being collecting Kenny Liebeer earlier on in the race, who is a little bit out of sync with everyone else. Keith Storey is still going in 13th ahead of Mark Stanton, who was upside down on that one. Andrei Pestov on his debut looks like he's going to bring it home. That's no mean feat. Mark Fuller and Chris Williamson now 5 laps down for Nijo, but still pointing in the right direction, which is, again, no mean feat around this circuit. I always find this circuit loses me slightly because it is like, you know those little cat, or I think they're called mice coasters, where they kind of, you go to a corner and you spin around really tightly and you get flung around everywhere. It just reminds me of one of those. Interesting, but a little bit deadly.
One thing, since Clark did that final 70th pit stop or whatever it was, he came out and obviously he was about 17 seconds behind Euler. The gap is now 8.4 seconds. Clark has been flying since his final pit stop, taking a significant amount of time every lap out of Euler. I believe Euler's just coasting it, as there are only 3 laps to go now. But if anything happened to Euler, for example the traffic, someone spins in front of him, he spins himself, OJ Clark could yet take that podium away. So Clark hasn't given up, he's given it his all, and he's put in some very competitive lap times his last few laps. And Euler's tyres may be going a bit off now, so he's just coasting it home, although he has replied this lap a little bit, so maybe that battle's over already. But Clark really flying at the end of this race, putting in a good effort, and fourth position, it's not a bad result.
I mean, not at all. And I think this will help out quite a lot of people in their various standings as well. Obviously green stripes will really hit home here, and they'll move up to second in the constructors because they're just 1 point behind Drake, who are second overall, and Drake obviously not collecting any points here at all, just Storey remaining in that one in 13th position. So that'll be toil and trouble for them. Red Archer will also move up ahead of Nordstone, because Red Archer have got second and 8th, whereas Nordstone just have a 7th with Pavel. And who else looks like they're going to be on the move as well? Now I'd say, yeah, Kerno will be moving closer. Oh no, yes, they will be moving closer to Hawkeye, because Hawkeye will be moving further away from Kerno. Get your maths right, Simon. Because of their excellent result, and they'll leapfrog Nijo. So, all good stuff going on, by the looks of it.
No,
Clark's still taking time out. On Phil, sorry.
I was going to say, no, all that constructor stuff is obviously very important towards next season, and prize money and all that sort of stuff. I'll be honest with you, I kind of look at all that stuff and it goes over my head. I've seen some of the stuff with R&D and it's like, I'm glad I'm not a team manager, that's to be honest with you. I'm just happy just to drive the car as quick as I can.
Not bad at all. Chris Williamson's got a puncher in 17th position. Late race drama. He goes 6 laps down and needs to keep this nice and out of the way from everyone, because whenever there's been someone T-boning Chris Williamson has been involved. AJ Clark just leapfrogging round, and Williamson getting nicely out of the way. Just needs to hobble it back as Dave Carr-Smith is on his final lap now. 17 seconds clear. Just quite happily sauntering through. Very quickly, your drivers of the day before we get to the end of the flag.
For me, Dave Carr-Smith.
Yeah, you can't really go wrong. Has played the strategy perfectly for himself, and it'd be interesting to ask him whether there was a change.
Fantastic stuff. Well, it may have been done on the fly. It may have just been all down to planning. Dave Carr-Smith wins the Zandvoort Grand Prix here for GPVWC's Super League in style for Green Stripes Racing. A wonderful 16 seconds clear from a heavily trafficked James Shepherd, who comes across to take a well-deserved second, trying out different strategies and not dancing to the tune of anyone else for Hawkeye. Third will be Lucas Euler. Once he gets home, he's just 5 seconds clear from OJ Clark, so he's hanging on in there just to the very last moment. He's got one last corner to go. So he pops out onto the home straight, and that will do nicely for him. A continuation of the Midnight Motorsport Podium Fest. OJ Clark, he's happy with that by the looks of it. Fourth position.
Here comes Wixie. Here comes Wixie. Final corner.
Nice one, mate. That's the way to do it. Like a race win for him.
Hey, good man. Well done. Rude Hoosterbeek then fifth for Nijo Racing. Alex Cooper sixth. Midnight Motorsports. So those two are one lap down. Luknovsky is seven for Nordzone, two laps down, as is David Junt. Tom Parker.
Yeah.
David Junt in eighth for Red Archer, ninth for Tom Parker, Woods Racing. As we see, Mark Wicks, well done, tenth position, off the marks now. Next one, we'll aim for ninth next time out. Christoph Lichtenstein then just outside the points for Green Stripes, 11. David Stanton, 12 for Constant. Keith Story, 13 for Drake Racing. Lichtenstein, Stanton, Story, all three laps down. Mark Stanton, four laps down for Constant. Andre Pestov's four laps down for Nordzone in 15. Five laps down, Mark Fuller. He had a last-minute drama for ST Racing and lost a lap there. And Chris Williamson got round with a puncture. In fact, he's still trying to make it through. He chose not to pit that lap. I think he thought that was his final lap. No, you've got to go round again. He's still limping round for Nijo, but he will be 17th and six laps down. Our retirements, Jeff Mead right at the end on lap 59, crashing out. Simon Cattell, very similar effort on 32. Moodley crashing on lap 12. Liebeer on lap 6. Wesley on the opening lap. And we lost Kieran Ryan with disconnection from the get-go. Wow. Good stuff, eh?
Yeah, enjoyed that one. It was a little bit bland in the middle, let's say. It was not much on-track action, unfortunately. We had some good battles sort of field at the early on stages of the race. The strategy unfolded about lap 40 when we realised what everyone was doing. So the end was a bit deflating, but we had plenty to talk about, so we filled in with, and obviously, some new things happening today. Yeah, pleasure to take on.
Fantastic. Phil?
Yeah, I suppose you can't have a bottle of excitement every single time we come out here. We had a very good race. We've a very deserving winner, and obviously we've got some feel-good stories up and down the field as well. So heading towards Nürburgring, we have a lot to think about going into the championship. Obviously, that's something to consider with Nick not shown. Are we now at the point of Lucas being champion-elect?
Indeed, and there'll be some good feel-good stories up and down the paddock, and I do enjoy a good feel. So we'll be back in 2 weeks' time for the Nürburgring in Germany. Completely different circuits what we've just been on. Any predictions, dare I say?
Well, just something I was going to say. Was that the last midnight race or two ago? Because look at the gap, Euler 39 seconds behind Dave Carr-Smith and a good chunk behind Shepherd as well. So maybe from now on we could see a lot more open races, predictions wise. You know, we could see a lot of different winners. I mean, Clark's proved he can be up there. Hoosterbeek's a guy who's not really shown his full potential, I don't think. So maybe we've seen the final Midnight Domination race a few races ago, and it could be all open now for the end of the season.
Indeed, and but obviously I think Lucas is going to have probably want to win at home. Obviously next race is his home race, so there'll be maybe that extra bit of effort, but we will probably see a bit of an inquiry, whether it's a case of the other teams have caught that much up, or have they just gone in a completely wrong direction and they just have not found their way back with the setup yet.
Who knows? It's all going to be found out on September 6th, where we'll be back on simrace.tv, where your collection of commentators will be taking you through the action. Might even see Lee out on track, given it is all, and trying to get himself back up into, or keep himself in the top 4 or 5 in the championship. If not, I'm sure you have someone exciting keeping you all up to date with the action. I think that's just about it to call it a day for today. I'd like to thank Philip Cullen and Lee Morris for providing a lot of the on-screen bands here today. And as ever, Simon Melhuish for being our cameraman extraordinaire, helping us out behind the scenes. My name is Simon Smith, and thank you very much for joining us for this coverage of GPVWC's Super League. You can sign up at gpvwc.com. Get yourself in on the action. You may see yourself on these pixely screens anytime soon. But until then, come back for us on the 6th of September. We'll be in the old Germany. Until then, you take care of yourselves. We'll see you soon. Bye for now. Sunday.